If I try hard, if I really concentrate, I can still remember when I was normal regarding Christmas. As a child, you couldn't have distinguished me from any of the others. When I was small, I too would thrill to the snap of a cracker. I too would salivate at the sight of a Christmas pudding. I didn't like eating it, but it always made me salivate. I counted up my Christmas cards as so many trophies, just like all my friends. And every year, I hoped against hope that there would be at least one among my aunts and uncles who just for once would not slip me a pair of underpants or some pyjamas, but give me a real present instead. But on the whole, I was able to make Christmas fairly painless. What changed everything irrevocably was a fact that had simply never occurred to me. Christmas as a service industry. It was something I'd never considered. Why should I? I knew that out-of-work actors were supposed to work on Christmas as a time when they could dress up as Santa Claus and earn enough money to get drunk enough to survive the festivities. I vaguely assumed that purveyors of Punch and Judy shows spent more time over Christmas working than they did enjoying themselves. Then, as I was born with a passionate and utterly praiseworthy loathing of all Punches and all Judies, what did I care? I supposed that card manufacturers and the specially recruited imbeciles who wrote the jokes for the crackers were hard put to get everything done in time. But what did any of this have to do with me? Absolutely nothing. What changed all that was a pair of remarkable people, a man and a woman. Their names were Lester Young and Billie Holiday. He played the tenor saxophone and she sang popular songs. They worked a lot together, and between them, they created such sorcery on record as to wreck the conventional paths of my life. By the time I was 15, I'd given up any idea of completing my intellectual training and was committed instead to sounding as much like Lester Young as possible. By the time I was 18, I'd reached the point where I was able to play occasionally at dances. By the time I was 20, I was a fully-fledged professional saxophone player. And that is, I spent most of my time lying in bed looking for work. The facts of that life were harsh enough. There were always more casual musicians available than there was work for them to do. What's more, being able to play better than the others was no help. It might have been if the band leaders we worked for had the faintest idea what any of us were supposed to be doing. But those band leaders, drawn from the nation's criminal classes, couldn't tell the difference between Artieshaw and Bernardshaw. So the whole thing was a lottery. Except for the 52nd and final week of the year, when the entire capitalist system was turned on its head and the wage slave suddenly found himself in command. Suddenly, it was a seller's market. In that hectic period, which ran from Christmas Eve to New Year's Eve, the working musician, cowed and browbeaten ever since January the 1st, found himself in demand for club functions, factory dances, family celebrations. He found himself invited to play at dance clubs, municipal halls, schoolrooms, back parlours, all sorts of places where people planned to express the deep religiosity of their reaction to Christmas by getting as stoned as possible, as quickly as possible, and jumping about making as much noise as possible. For this, they required the services of some sort of band. A few tried to use gramophone records, but soon realised that if there's no band to belittle and poke fun at, where is the joy of Christmas? Well, at first I didn't mind any of this. After a year spent hanging around hoping for the occasional night's employment, it seemed nothing short of wonderful to me when three different gangsters asked me to do them the immense favour of working for them on Christmas Eve. Why, I was so nonplussed by the sheer novelty of the situation that I said yes to all three and failed to take advantage of the situation by demanding extra money. At this stage, of course, I was still unaware of any special problem attaching to the magician's Christmas. Until the moment when it dawned on me, with what the Victorian novelists used to call a sickening flood, that I had drifted unwittingly into the Christmas industry. At first, I was blissfully unaware that there was any problem, but then the terrible discovery hit me. The discovery to do with a very peculiar and deeply distressing nature of English musical life. The English as a race tend not to be terribly musical. Now, I remember that when I first started out as a musician, I was taken aside one day by a veteran of the profession and given a warning. He was a very old, gnarled man, bent with the weight of years. No teeth, a few wisps of white hair. I think he must have been at least 32 years old. And he told me that the bitterest pill I would ever have to learn to swallow was that the English were indifferent to good music. It took me years to find out how wrong he was. The English are not indifferent to good music. They actively detest it. And one of the ways this detestation comes out is at Christmas when they unleash a tidal wave of musical idiocy. Now, so far as I know, no musicologist, no theologist has attempted any correlation of this manifestation of musical madness with the celebration of Christmas. The thesis awaits the world. What happens is that the average English musical mutt, a man who for 51 weeks of the year is content to go to dances and be docile enough to dance to whatever the band plays, suddenly turns into that terrifying ignoramus, the man who knows what he likes, and instantly starts laying it on the band. For instance, there's a piece of music, I won't deign to call it a composition, a piece of music called Underneath the Spreading Chestnut Tree. In this song, the idea is for the dancer to imitate the action of the words by performing certain operations on himself. For instance, when he reaches the word chestnut, he taps himself first on the chest and then on the nut. This will give you some idea of the power of the intellectual lobby which used to haunt our dance halls. Anyway, at Christmas, a little more spice was added to the wooing by the simple amendment of getting the male dancers to tap each other's heads and chests. The upshot of this amendment to the original choreography means that long before the dancers ended, a free-for-all has begun, usually under a huge banner hung from wall to wall reading, "Peace and goodwill to all men." The Hokey Cokey was worse, because in this amazing tribal dance, the women were invited to be as boisterous as the men. Now, in this dance, the whole thing was an excuse for a large bunch of drunks to bang into each other and shout, till at the end they were all lying on the floor waiting for next Christmas. For the musician, the only trouble was that in order to get themselves into the ultimate paroxysm of drunken narcolepsy, the dancers had to repeat the song over and over and over. And by the end of it, the band was bored, tired and disenchanted, as well as disgusted. But the worst case of all, worse even than the maudlin renditions of Auld Lang Syne, worse even than the lachrymose wailing supposed to be White Christmas, worse than anything really, has always been the conga, a Latin American enormity which was part of the great tidal wave of South American rhythm which washed across our shores once upon a time, leaving a residue of sambas, rumbas and cha-chas to distract us from the serious business of life, which is of course to play good jazz. The special popularity of the conga is due to two very unusual factors. First, the dancers don't have to look at each other, which, believe me, in most dance halls of my experience, is a wondrous blessing. Instead, the dancer gets behind somebody in a crocodile and puts his hands vaguely where he thinks their hips should have been. This act very often leads to what a punster might define as a touching example of lightning romance, and all without having to look at each other. No wonder the conga has always been so popular. But the second uniqueness of the dance is even more potent. The conga is the only dance in the entire repertoire where the dancers can, if they wish, leave the premises without stopping dancing. Once they get the crocodile going and have managed to remember the important bit of the lyric, which goes, "I, I, conga," they begin to generate their own rhythmic energy and are free to wander where they please. I've played at Christmas and New Year's festivities where the conga line, having wandered out into the street, has never returned at all, leaving the musicians to sit there wondering whatever happened to them. The most spectacular example of conga madness I can recall started in Clapham one Christmas Eve. After a short warm-up period of not more than half an hour, the conga line vanished through the front entrance. We went on playing for a while simply because there was no machinery to stop us. But when another 20 minutes had gone by and still no sign of the dancers, there seemed no point to it. So we gradually stopped and just sat there, waiting either for somebody to come back or for midnight to come, and we could all officially get out of the place. At 12, we were paid off and went home, wondering what sort of Christmas the missing conga dancers were likely to have, and hoping it would turn out to be a lousy one. The following Christmas, I found myself on a gig with the drummer who had been at the previous year's debacle, and he told me that sometime in June, the remains of that conga line had turned up in Caracas, Venezuela, without passports, but still dancing. The moral of all this is never believe any word any musician ever tells you. His brains have been rotted by his annual encounters with Christmas.
Christmas Punch was presented by Benny Green. Tomorrow at the same time, Alan Corran will be giving us some tips for the festive season.